Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the first of the state sessions this morning. I'm really excited about moderating this session. My colleague Pablo asked me to step in on this session. Actually, I'm one of the curators on the second floor of the workshops and interactive, but have a background as a psychologist and also work as a professor in the area between science and art. So it's actually a great pleasure to be hosting and moderating this session, as it brings me back to also some of my earlier work and roots. The mixture that we have today in terms of the session in relation to neurobiology and emotions and empathy, I think is quite an interesting trajectory of work that has been emerging in a steady and quite a profound way in the last 20 years in particular. And the guests that we have speaking today are also representing this area with really valuable research. So I'd like to introduce Laura Kaltwasser, who is working here in Berlin at the Humboldt University as a postdoc researcher. She's a social cultural identity researcher, and she will be giving a 15-minute conversation about her work. Each speaker will be speaking for that length of time, followed then by a 5-minute Q&A. So I'd like us to kind of keep on time with that, and I'll be waving as much as I can from my corner seat over there. And then there will be an open panel discussion for the floor as well at the end. Following Laura, then we have Sebastian Korb, also a postdoc researcher from Vienna in the psychology department there. His focus will be on neuroscience and psychology. And then finally, Professor Isabel Dziobek, also from the Humboldt University in the Berlin School of Mind and Brain, will be following up with her research in terms of cognitive behavioral research and psychotherapy. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce the first speaker, which will be Laura. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you for this kind introduction, and thank you for having me here at this very inspiring festival, and for giving me the chance to present our work. I'm a postdoc at the moment, and I will present some work that I did during my PhD at the Berlin School of Mind and Brain. And the title of my talk is See My Fear and Act Prosocial. Emotions have a quite strong influence on cooperation behavior. For once, they directly affect behavior through motivation, but they also indirectly affect cooperation behavior as we infer the emotions of others when we interact with them, a thing called empathy. And the work I conducted during my PhD was investigating whether which role emotions play in cooperation behavior in consideration of the underlying physiological reactions. So here we can use methods such as EEG to better understand the temporal dimension of the neural activity while we are processing social or emotional stimuli, but also other people are using fMRI to understand the neural structures that are involved in those processes. And the work we did was with a focus on individual differences. So we used tasks like the one you see there, many different tasks where people have to recognize emotions, and we try to quantify this ability. And we did that by using a statistical tool called structural equation modeling, which in the end is just a measure of estimating shared variance between different constructs like emotions or cooperation behavior or physiological responses. The big question is, what are the consequences of those individual differences? What does it mean to be good or bad in empathy? And here, the empathy altruism hypothesis comes into the game, and it states that empathy provokes a motivation that is directed towards the goal of increasing the welfare of the other. And that's also what people find when they train empathy, for example, through loving kindness meditation, or when they induce empathy with heartbreaking stories. One sees that people cooperate more afterwards in socioeconomic dilemmas that I will explain in a second, but also in helping scenarios. And using the methods that we had in my former research group, we were slightly rephrasing the question, and we rather ask what are the emotion recognition abilities underlying the prosocial behavior. You will see in a minute why we try to rephrase this question. And one reason was also that we wanted to better understand the role of each specific emotion in cooperation behavior. What role does happiness play in compared to fear, for example? And there is some previous evidence that there might be something special about fear. There's one study that found that people who were better in recognizing fears were also the ones that were more favorable towards others and that helped more. And on the other hand, we know from antisocial populations, however that's quite a contested finding at the moment, that they might be particularly impaired in recognizing emotions of distress, such as fear and sadness. But when we talk about emotions and cooperation behavior, there's also another variable that's quite interesting, and that's the tendency to express emotions. The question is, why do we actually express emotions? And evolution theory predicts that actually our tendency to express emotion might be a form of honest and unfalsifiable signals that allow us to connect with other like-minded others that also want to cooperate with us, and importantly for evolution theory, outside of the family. And that's what some people already found, that there is a correlation between the cooperativeness, how cooperative or pro-social people are, and their tendency to express emotions. But again, it's not so clear what role does the specific emotion play. Is it just that they express more positive emotions, or do they also express more negative emotions? And that's another question that we were tackling here. Regarding the measures that we use, so how can we actually quantify those abilities. My former research group developed different batteries of small tasks that are performance measures of social cognition and that are quantifying individual differences in social competencies. Why is it important to use performance measures here? It's one way of trying to quantify empathy, but the good thing here is that there is less response distortion. That's what we call in psychology the process when actually not the construct that we are interested in is affecting the response, but something else. And if we have some not so well-designed questionnaires for empathy, people might just pretend that they are empathetic and always cross, oh yes, I feel always with the other people, not because they are like that, but because they want to project a good image of themselves. So another way to do so is to try really to get at the core of the ability and use those different tasks. And here we have some tasks that I'm not going to talk about today, but that are also quite interesting, of face cognition, where people are asked to depict minimal spatial changes. As you might see here, is a small difference between picture A and B, and we try to use this as an indicator for the ability to recognize faces. And people differ in it. Some people are quite good in it and others not. And then we can ask, how is that different actually from recognizing houses, and what are the neuronal mechanisms that play a role here? Other tasks that were developed in our group are emotion recognition ability tasks. That's one of them. I will show you another one. We have about, I think, 8 tasks. And people are asked to label particular emotions or to recognize or memorize them. And then we also have some tasks of emotion expression, where people are asked to express emotions, and we quantify their reaction with computerized toolboxes that I will also show you in a minute, or we can also use electromyography. That's something that Sebastian will also talk about in his talk. So before we come to the experiment that I conducted, I just want to say a few words about the brain, about what's actually happening in the brain when we recognize an emotion, and that's a very simplified picture that I give here, but I think it's quite interesting to get a basic understanding of what's happening. So if we see a fearful face like the following, we have a distributed neural network that's processing the information. There is a core system in the occipital cortex, so in the back of the head, that's responsible for feature detection and identity processing, and then later on, but not necessarily serially, maybe also parallelly, other structures of the limbic system are involved that are responsible, for example, for the processing of emotion. In the example of the fearful face, we would have in the core system the feature detect detection in the inferior occipital cortex that's very sensitive, for example, to the eye movement of a fearful face, and that requires a fast response. And then this one is connected with other limbic structures, such as the amygdala or the insula that's processing emotions. And regarding the timing, we know from methods such as EEG that have a quite good temporal resolution that the first perceptual processes of the emotion actually probably take place around 120 milliseconds in the occipital cortex, and then later on also the whole body is involved, and we can measure differences due to emotion, for example, in the heartbeat or the skin temperature or the skin conductance. And later on only there is a retrieval of contextual knowledge. So in our example, I see the fearful face, and later on my extended system might actually process that I know this person from high school and that I should trust her because she was a friend and I should react fast. Okay, that's one example of how an emotional face is processed. And now let's turn to how we actually quantified the cooperation behavior or the prosocial behavior. And here we used socioeconomic decision-making tasks that are a way of quantifying strategic interactions. Sorry, I just have to take one. So they are stemming from behavioral economics, and they try to simulate real-world strategic interaction. And the economic theory actually predicts that there is something called economic rationality, or also maybe you know that under the name of homo economicus, the idea that actually the human always wants to increase its own payoff and maximize self-interest. But behavioral economics taught us that that's actually not the case, that people have a tendency to cooperate. And one dilemma that we can use to study this tendency to cooperate is the prisoner's dilemma. And here, a participant, in this case me, is faced with two options to decide. One can cooperate by maximizing the joint outcome, so I would know also my partner gets also 300 cents, or one can defect and act egoistically and decide for defect to increase only the own payoff. And the famous Nash equilibrium would say that the rational choice here is to defect, since it maximizes the own outcome. But that's not what people do. Like a quite early study showed that at least around 40% of the people tend to cooperate. Of course, there are many other factors like individual differences or context influences, but we do have a tendency to cooperate, and there are individual differences in it. Okay. Thank you. So to recap what the study was about, we were interested in how our tendency to express emotions and our spontaneous and our ability to recognize emotions is linked to cooperation behavior and socioeconomic games. And that was based on previous evidence that I stated before. And we used this method called structural equation modeling in order to quantify the relationship between the different constructs. So we tested 113 participants. They played three games over the internet with putative partners, but in fact it was the computer, but they saw their partners indicated via picture, and we also video recorded them during the prisoner's dilemma during one of the games. The other ones are, I will not go into detail now, but they are a little bit simpler games, but comparable to the prisoner's dilemma. And we also had three tasks of emotion recognition accuracy. And then we also, in order to compare our results to previous studies, we also used an empathy questionnaire. And this is how the prisoner's dilemma looked like. So the participant was introduced to its partner, and then he saw the decision matrix, again, where he can cooperate and increase joint outcome or defect and increase the own outcome. Then there was a variable interval where the partner decided, and then there was this feedback about the partner's choice. So sometimes your partner would be nice and cooperate and sometimes not. And that's where we recorded the emotion expression. And the guys of you have been to the Naturkunde Museum on Thursday evening. They might have seen a quite similar software there in the entrance hall where you could try out different emotions and the computer would actually recognize. And that's what we also used here. This software here at CERT gives you an activity for each action unit that's responsible for the emotion expression, but also composite scores. So here I'm smiling, it's now too small, but you can see that the joy score is going up and the sad and anger score is staying down. This is one example of emotion recognition accuracy. The participant just saw one of the faces at a time and had to indicate for the bottom or the top half which emotion is shown. And that's of course more difficult than when you see the whole face. And yeah, now let's turn to the results. This is the depiction of the structural equation modeling. So we have indicators that are measured, three emotion recognition tasks that load onto a latent factor of emotion recognition. And then we're just interested in how they link and if that's significant. And those numbers are quite small and they are not significant. There's no relationship. But then we did small models for each emotion. And we actually only found that the ability to recognize fear is correlated to the ability to cooperate. And regarding the emotion expression, we analyzed the data separately for the trials where the partner cooperated and the trials where the partner defected. That's in the bottom. And here we actually saw that cooperative people smile more after their partner's cooperation and they defect more after their partner's, they are more angry after their partner's defection. So that's like here an interaction between individual differences and the situational variable. And to sum up, modeling emotion-specific factors suggested that more prosocial individuals are better in recognizing fear and they tend to express more spontaneous emotions during the prisoner's dilemma. How can we interpret that? I would say that based on the empathy altruism hypothesis, our data suggests that there is a sensitivity to the emotional state of a person in distress or need, which is associated with a motivation to help. Importantly, this is not a causal mechanism here, it's just a correlation, a shared variance. What's underlying is a different question, but also very important. And now, regarding the expressiveness, also our data suggests that expressiveness might be a factor that fosters reciprocal interaction and works like a sign showing I'm up for cooperating because I'm smiling or I'm rather not. That's pretty straightforward. And I think as a general take-home message, I would say emotions are social signals. They are not only making us fit for survival and making us jump to the side when we see a snake or a car, but they also convey information and they are partly so powerful because they work without words. Thank you for your attention.
Perfect timing. Is this, yeah, this is fine. Super interesting. I found the connection with being able to read fear so important, really, in this signifier of like pro-social behavior. There was just, I guess, just to have the fill the 5 minutes of Q&A, really, in a way, was to discuss how you would sort of see some of these findings relating to maybe more practical real-world situations. And I'm thinking in particular of a friend of mine who is a clinical psychologist who's been working with people who have been reoffending in prison. And he has been looking at brain rehabilitation and finding actually that people who are consistently reoffending and then therefore going into jail in a prolonged time actually had some brain damage. And this was actually relating to their inability as well to read some of these pro-social behaviours. So when you flagged in your first slide about some of these anti-social societies, we're talking in a sense, and I know that it's a very problematic term, but people who basically are causing trouble in our society. And I thought his work was really interesting in a very, very practical way when we talk about particularly people who might be coming from already very disadvantaged social situations and are asking the questions in relation to poverty or economic situation, but actually his research exposed the fact that actually they were suffering also from brain damage, perhaps maybe at birth, but perhaps maybe because they were in gangs and they were fighting and they would have had a blow to the head or something like this. So that for me is a really practical example of how this type of work in the lab actually really relates to real world situations, for example, in how we rethink about how people read prosocial behaviours and how the work kind of filters through. So I just would like you to expand maybe on how you might also see some of your work relating to practical insertions in social life and or in daily life, and what you might see as steps towards your work coming out of the lab and into that situation.
Is this working? Yeah. Maybe expanding on the link between the impairment of recognizing fear and being pro-social, also regarding criminal offenders. Blair and colleagues that did this meta-analysis that I also presented, they propose a development model that, maybe brain damage can be one factor, but they have a model that works completely without brain damage, explaining that a child who grows up and never learns to associate harm being done to someone else with a fearful or sad expression actually will have this inability to recognize this, and therefore maybe a lack of motivation to act pro-socially and to not act anti-socially, because it can literally not feel the pain of the other. This development model can be very useful to explain it. But as I said, it's contested, also because the data is interestingly quite cultural specific. Also, for example, the concept of psychopathy seems to work differently in the United States and in European countries. There is some studies also from Oliver Wilhelm and colleagues and people in Zurich that suggest that they were testing criminal offenders in the prison, and they actually did not really find an impairment in emotion recognition. And they were focusing more on another factor of antisocial behavior, which is the motivation to harm one other and maybe even feeling lust by harming one. I'm not sure if that means that the development model is not usable, but I think we cannot only focus on emotion recognition. There is also something like the motivation that we have to tackle more.
And speaking on that question of cultural specificity, in a way, I mean, often we're also even taught in sort of Western society that showing your emotion is a sign of weakness in some way, or that you would put yourself into a weaker position. And I'm thinking of like business models in a sense, or business training, where actually a sort of a alpha behavioral traits in a sense are sort of encouraged in a way as actually any sort of display or the poker face in a sense. Could you maybe expand a little bit on what your thinking might be in relation to that, and whether you sort of see this as something that is a good example in a sense, and particularly in relation to how we actually work in a business sense? Because it's, you know, perhaps we could hypothetically say that this model has maybe also then of not showing your weakness and being super, super strong all of the time maybe leads to certain types of business practice, for example, or that perhaps in educational situations or in interdisciplinary, multicultural work contexts, that we actually need to learn to be sensitive to the other person's way of displaying emotions. I'm thinking of cultures where actually it's a different facial kind of display, in a sense. Could you maybe expand a little bit on what your thoughts might be on this?
Yeah, I'm thinking that, of course, it's always important to be sensitive to the emotions of others, and I don't think that that we will get into a society where, one thing is the technological development, but still having Skype and everything, I think still the face will always be there and it will always be important. And people, I mean, I notice it myself, I prefer to Skype with the camera on and see the other's face. And that's different than if I'm actually really facing the person, but at least it's present and it's more multi-dimensional, multi-sensory input. And so I don't really think that we will get into a society where people walk around with poker faces, and I think it's a thin line. I think, of course, being too expressive can be detrimental, but I think that's then a question maybe also of emotion regulation. As long as it's kind of happening natural, and that's what it is, it's actually, that's also why it's so interesting to study spontaneous emotion expression. It's sometimes quite hard to control. I mean, if you're not an actor or not focusing on it, it's an implicit process that's always going along. So I think that's part of us being human, and I think that will always, I mean, that's also, if you talk to someone at a phone and you don't see him, you will also express emotions.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you for raising the technological element. I think we can bring this to the panel, and Sebastian, if you'd like to kick off. Thank you very much.
Okay, so hello, and I would also like to thank the organizers for inviting me and actually for putting up this fantastic festival. I really enjoyed the format. I was here yesterday all day. So I hope you can hear me well. I will have to partly turn around. I'm half psychologist and half neuroscientist, and today I will talk about sensory-motor simulation and its role in emotional cognition. So let's start off with what is sensory-motor simulation? And it can be defined as the sub-threshold copy, or at least often it's a sub-threshold copy, of a perceived movement or emotional expression. And when this happens, the sensory-motor simulation, it actually leads to a reactivation or partial reactivation of the same neurons, of the same parts of the brain, which are required to produce the movement itself. And one example of this is facial mimicry. So I'm going to define it closer, better in a second, but facial mimicry is basically when you imitate a facial expression you perceive in somebody else. And sensory motor simulation in general, and more specifically facial mimicry, contributes to emotional cognition, and these processes might be delayed or impaired in autism spectrum disorders, and I think in the next talk we'll be hearing more about this. So here's just a little sketch to sort of show how I think this works in a nutshell. You perceive a facial expression, and then you produce facial mimicry spontaneously, and you get feedback from your face back to your brain, this contributes to emotional cognition and might be important also for empathy, so for being able to share the emotions that you perceive in others. So let's focus on facial mimicry, which I would say is the spontaneous and rapid imitation of a perceived facial expression. And here is an example. Imagine Mitt Romney laughs at Obama, and Obama laughs back. Okay, great, so you can call this facial mimicry. But in reality, in the lab, we don't usually have two people interacting with each other because we want to control everything better. So we show on a computer screen, we show either pictures or videos of facial expressions. They can also be much more subtle than that. And a participant would sit in front and would either passively look at these or rate them or do some task, while at the same time we record facial muscles using electrodes in the face. And the two muscles which are commonly recorded are the zygomaticus, which is marked in red here on this face, and which is involved in smiling, and the corrugator, which is not marked in red, but is just above the eyebrows, and is important for frowning and for anger. So now when you show many faces to people and you average over the trials, you see that the corrugator here on the left is going to be more activated to angry than to happy faces, and the reverse is true for the zygomaticus. Facial mimicry does not only occur in adult humans, but also in infant humans. Apparently already 36 hours after birth, children tend to imitate facial movements. Now there are more and more papers coming out showing that this happens also in other non-human primates, like orangutans and old world monkeys. Moreover, facial mimicry is difficult to inhibit. I have also contributed to this. So for example, when you show smiles to people and you ask them to quickly smile whenever they see a smile and to remain neutral when they see a neutral face, and then in another condition you reverse it and you record their psychometrics, you find that actually people are better and faster at smiling in response to a smile. So, and this happens already at 250 milliseconds after the onset of the picture. And then in those trials where they're supposed to remain neutral in their own face, they make mistakes when you're displaying a happy face. When they manage to refrain from smiling, nevertheless, the zygomaticus, the smiling muscle, is more active in response to happy than to neutral faces. Okay, so facial mimicry, you know, we can find it early on, we can find it in other species, it's difficult to inhibit, and it can also occur when you're not even consciously aware of the presence of an emotional expression. So you can show this with healthy participants like you and me, hopefully, by showing them just for 30 milliseconds, so very briefly, a facial expression followed by a neutral expression, and you would see that they nevertheless mimic the expression they were not even aware of. Or you can study this with patients who have lesions in the brain. For example, here you see an MR or a CT scan of a patient who is lacking the right occipital cortex. And what this leads to is that everything that is on the left visual field of that person, the person is not going to be aware of. And nevertheless, if you show facial expressions to that left visual field, you will find facial mimicry. So that's interesting to me. So how do we know that facial mimicry is important for emotion recognition? One line of evidence, I don't have much time to go in all the details, but one line of evidence is that when you block facial mimicry, for example, by asking people to keep a pen in their mouth so they cannot smile, or by taking advantage of the fact that some people get Botox injections for usually aesthetic reasons, and this leads to paralysis of the muscles, and therefore you have no longer facial mimicry, well, in these cases, you find that recognition of facial expression slows down or is impaired, and you find even differences in the activation of the amygdala, which is an important center in the brain for emotions, in response to angry faces. So, since I've started talking about the amygdala in the brain, let's go look more in detail about facial mimicry in the brain. And in order for facial mimicry to occur and to influence emotion recognition, you need some sort of fast visual processing, which I think could occur subcortically, since based also on the studies we showed, I just showed you with the patients with lesions in the visual cortices. You also need a motor output that would be the facial mimicry, and then you need to process the feedback from the face, which is called the somatosensory processing. So it's sort of the tactile information coming from your face. Where does this happen in the brain? Well, the motor output can come from several motor areas. Some of them are subcortical, like the basal ganglia. But I'm going to focus on a cortical area, which is the primary motor cortex, marked in red here. So that's your brain, and the eyes would be on the left. Yeah, and so once you have facial mimicry coming, for example, from the motor cortex, how do you and where do you process the feedback? And one area which I'm going to focus on is the somatosensory cortex, which is just behind the motor cortex. And I'm now going to explain you a study I was involved with, where we tried to study exactly the role of this primary motor and somatosensory cortices, which are here shown as M1 and S1, in facial mimicry and emotion recognition. So we had 30 participants, and we first put them into the scanner, into the MR scanner, and there we asked them to voluntarily smile, and sometimes they were also being touched with this pistons, which are these blue things attached to the head coil, on their cheek. And this was important to locate the areas of the brain in the primary motor and somatosensory cortices, which innervate the left cheek. Then we went, oh, and here's a representation of where they are. And then we went and used TMS, which is a technique to inhibit parts of the brain. So it's transcranial magnetic stimulation, but the name is actually misleading, because most of the time it's not used to stimulate, but to inhibit. We could inhibit these parts of the brain and then see what happens to facial mimicry. How did we induce facial mimicry? We showed videos in which expressions would change from one emotion to the other. For example, let me see if this works. You would have here this face, which slowly goes from angry to happy. And the task for the participant is to indicate by pushing a button when the switch occurs. And of course, we recorded facial mimicry. And so now let's see if there was any facial mimicry. So in this graph, you see the 5 seconds of the stimulus going from angry to happy. and on the y-axis you see the intensity of this mimicry in the zygomaticus. And these three darker lines represent the zygomaticus, which increases in activation along with the increase in the stimulus. And the corrugator, the frowning muscle, decreases and then stays flat. So, okay, there seems to be mimicry. The question now, is it modulated by inhibiting those motor and somatosensory areas? And there we found, so first of all, I have to explain how this graph works. So here you have basically on the y-axis, on the vertical axis, you have the intensity of the mimicry. And at the bottom, on the x-axis, you have the three conditions. Vertex is the control condition because that's the top of the head. And then you have the primary somatosensory and, and motor cortex. And yes, we found reduced mimicry after inhibition of both motor and somatosensory areas. Also we found an effect on the behavior. So people were slower at detecting the smiles. However, these effects were only found in female participants and not in male participants. We had half-half. And actually, in male participants, there was no effect, and if anything, it went the other direction. So I don't have a really good answer to that, but it's definitely an interesting avenue for me for future research to investigate how gender differences might actually affect the way we mimic and how mimicry is coded in the brain. And now, in the little time I have, I'm going to talk about oxytocin, which is a hormone. Most of you have probably heard about oxytocin. It has lots of effects in the periphery of the body. Some of them are involved in labor, for example, uterus contractions or milk release, whatever. I'm not going to talk about this because oxytocin also acts in the brain. One way to get some oxytocin into the brain of people is by having them sprayed into the nose. And it usually takes about 45 minutes before it is active in the brain. That at least is the idea. Oxytocin, that's also why you might have heard about it, is very much in the mouth of not only the general public, but also the researchers. So if you go on PubMed, which is a research tool for science articles, and you type oxytocin, you find that in the last 50 or 60 years, the number of articles has really skyrocketed. And I'm going to focus now on the role of oxytocin in social behavior. Also there, one important aspect of oxytocin might be that it increases trust. And indeed, if you go on Google and type oxytocin trust, you might find something called liquid trust, which is the world's first and only oxytocin product specially formulated to make people trust you. So now be assured, I did not use it today, I did not spray the room with it. And also, I don't really think it works, so I would not recommend it. Nevertheless, there is some research suggesting that oxytocin increases caregiving behavior, and it makes people focus more on the eye region of faces, and it might improve the way they can perceive facial expressions and other social signals. So based on this, we had a hypothesis that oxytocin might actually be implicated in emotional cognition, but by the way of increasing facial mimicry. And moreover, because of the role of oxytocin in caregiving behavior, we thought, well, maybe this might work especially with infant faces. So what did we do? We had 60 participants and did a double-blind placebo-controlled design where 30 got oxytocin in their nose and the other ones, they got a placebo and nobody knows who gets what. And then we showed them stimuli with, again, shifting expressions. And we had adult, but also infant expressions. So I'm going to play the infant expression. And so it's a happy baby who gets very, very sad. 3? Okay, awesome. So we recorded facial EMG, again, from the zygomaticus and the corrugator. And so what did we find? So here I'm going to show the activation of the corrugator, which is the frowning muscle, again over the 5 seconds of the video. And when the video goes from angry to happy, the activity of the corrugator goes down. But when the video is reversed and goes from happy to angry, the activity of the corrugator goes up. That's what you would expect. That's facial mimicry. Now, in red, you see the corrugator in the group that got the oxytocin. And well, you don't need even statistics to basically see that there is a much higher increase of anger mimicry in the oxytocin group compared to the placebo group in blue. Then when you split this by by the two type of stimuli which we had, so the adult and the infant phases, you find that the effect is somewhat stronger in the infant phases, which are here in blue, compared to the adult phases here in red. And then what happened to the mimicry of happiness? So here now I'm showing the activity of the zygomaticus, the smiling muscle, which stays basically flat when the stimulus goes from happy to angry. But when the stimulus goes from angry to happy, you have facial mimicry, you have an increase of the zygomaticus. But this increase is not modulated very much by oxytocin. So the oxytocin group is here in sort of pinkish, and in turquoise you have the placebo group. And there is a trend for an effect, but it's not a strong effect. So, little summary. I've explained or tried to explain what sensory motor simulation is, and I focused on facial mimicry. And I've mostly presented two experiments. One where we tried to reduce the amount of facial mimicry using this TMS, where we inhibited motor and somatosensory areas. And the second study was where we tried to increase facial mimicry using intranasal oxytocin. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention and my collaborators across three universities. Thank you.
Wow, a panel where everyone stops almost bang on 15 minutes. It's amazing. Well done. Thank you. I just wanted to pick up actually on the faking it issue in a way. Spraying oxytocin, possibly, let's imagine I'm super intelligent and I'm not very good in social situations. Actually, I'm hyper awkward, but I know that I really need to improve on it. I look up some research, I see all about facial mimicry, I train myself, and then I go out to the disco and I'm like, yeah. You know, do you think that this is something that the world of sort of faking emotions is actually something that might increase, or what do you think of this learning, in a sense, that happens with behaviors, particularly with people who, I guess, know that it's a struggle or an inability in themselves, but actually have the capacity to maybe train themselves?
Okay. Yeah, that's an interesting question. I have tried it on myself, but I didn't go dance with it, so I don't know the full answer. I would say that taking oxytocin should definitely take away your anxiety. So it's an anxiolytic also, it should calm you down. And that by itself might actually be a good thing, right? Now concerning whether you will be better at faking emotions, I actually expect it to be the reverse, in the sense that because you're going to be more calm and more trusting, you are actually going to show more of your emotions. However, what I was trying to study is whether you are becoming more aware of the emotions of others. And it seems to be the case, although it might not be for all emotions the same, so it might be that you're especially aware of sort of, I mean, I called it anger, but it was actually distress in infants. So you might be aware especially of that. And also, I didn't have time to get into that, but oxytocin is often described as a sort of cuddling hormone and that only elicits bonding and positive emotions. But more recent research suggests that that's only a partial truth, because you might also have paroxysm, so in a sense that you're good with the people of your group, but you're actually really harsh with people which are not in your group. So I don't know. It's still an investigation, and I think you can buy it easily on the internet. You can buy liquid trust, for example, on the internet. I don't know if it works. Also, they say you should spray it as a perfume.
All right. Okay.
In that way, even if some of that would get into your nose and into your brain, it would get into your brain and not in other people's brain. Therefore, you will becoming trusting, yeah, and they will not trust you more. So I don't think this is actually what they intended to.
Yeah. And something maybe to pick up in the panel, but I just want to kind of flag it now, is actually how this relates to robotic interactions and facial mimicry in relation to how you perhaps this is not something particularly within your field in terms of the application of your work, but I was also thinking about that in the overall state kind of conversation in terms of the sentimental machine, like how this facial mimicry would be, I can imagine, something very important for technologists to pay attention to, particularly in relation to robots who might be in care situations in the future.
Yeah, that's true. In my work, I mostly focus on that type of mimicry which you basically cannot see with your eye.
Okay.
That's why I'm using electrodes. And also, most of the time when you put participants, and to be honest, they're often students who do this because they get a couple of bucks or because they get course credits. So they're not particularly interested in doing a lot of facial expressions. So they're not smiling, doing big phony smiles, or frowning a lot in response to these stimuli. Actually, it's even the more surprising that we get this facial mimicry nevertheless. So it is that's why I claim it is really this spontaneous reaction which comes up even if you don't try to. But it doesn't have to be always visible. It can be a very small intensity. However, it is true that there's also another type of mimicry which is visible. Some of it can even be controlled, and some of it might even be socially appropriate. You know, we know we are supposed to behave in a certain way. Just look at the legs of the two. Yes. So people tend to imitate each other, and this is usually promoting that the conversation and interaction goes well. Although we also heard yesterday Ursula Hess in a comment saying that, maybe it was Maya Pantic saying that, you know, it can also go overboard.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
if you start to over-imitate, then the other person goes like, this is a weirdo. Yeah. And
so the authenticity of the interaction is actually highly valued.
Yeah. So if you build a robot that sort of does it too much, then it might actually come across like sort of weird and turning you off rather than promoting interaction.
Which is interesting in relation to the research with the children who are finding interactions with some robots actually very calming and helpful, because it actually sort of levels perhaps on their particular way of communicating. But on that level, we have to press on, and I think Isabel will be a nice junction into the next next presentation. Thank you, Sebastian.
Okay. Hi, good morning, everybody. Hi, Teresa. Hi, Pablo. Thanks for inviting me again to this very exciting event. I'm looking forward to scouring around after this session. I'm going to show you today, or in the next 15 minutes, work of mainly two studies that we have been doing in my group over the past almost 6 or 7 years, focusing on the trainability of empathy in individuals with autism. And I want to start off by showing you a video and asking you to try to really watch, observe, and get into that. Okay. I think we get enough. I don't know what you felt, but certainly whenever I watch this again, I feel that my body goes into this inner imitation and that I feel to tremble as well. And that's exactly the example of what happens to us when we watch a tightrope walker, that actually the early philosopher used already, Theodor Lips, in the beginning of the 19th century, actually, to explain what he means with the term Einfühlung. And Einfühlung later turned into the term empathy, actually. And for him, empathy was a very bodily-based, very kinesthetic process. And he meant with the simulation of the dynamic bodily state of another person with the own body. So an inner imitation or an inner synchronization. And for him, that really represented also the basis for understanding other people's emotions. Now, for many, many decades, certainly in psychological science, two other facets of empathy were much more in the focus of research, and that was cognitive empathy, the understanding broadly of the mental states and emotions of another person on a more cognitive level, and then also emotional empathy, meaning the experience of an emotional reaction to the observed emotional state of another person, so this being more an emotional process, really. And while we know that all of those different facets of empathy are facets on their own rights, we still don't know very much about how they actually interact. In part, actually, Laura's and Sebastian's work was trying to tease this apart a little bit. And that's exactly what we did also in my group. And we asked us the question, can we actually train those facets of empathy? And the studies that I'm going to show you, we actually did in autism. Why autism? Now, autism involves core deficits in social interaction and in empathy that are sometimes even selective. Selective meaning that everything else in the behavior and the being is quote-unquote normal, is not deviant from others, but the social interaction really is. And that makes it not only interesting as a model for social cognition and the social brain, but obviously also, me being a clinical psychologist, I also work, I actually do therapy with people with autism. I'm obviously also interested in seeing how we can help them to overcome some of those problems. Now I want to show you part of this video here, actually, where Carl, who's a New Yorker engineer, talks a little bit about his way of perceiving the social world. He was actually diagnosed with Asperger's syndrome many years ago.
It does not come naturally to us, whereas to most people it does come naturally, as does picking up on nonverbal cues such as facial expression, body language, tone of voice, and things like that. And, you know, any subtleties in those areas are completely lost on us. The more blatant ones I've generally been able to pick up on, but it has to be very, very blatant.
You see, he talks about his way of perceiving social signals, which is a real difficulty for him. And based on this observation that this naturalistic way of perceiving social signals is impaired, the subtleties are impaired, we actually came up with an intervention that focuses on training, recognizing emotions, complex emotions in the face, in voices, and also in more complex social interactions. We teamed up with almost 80 actors that produced with us together in a film studio stimuli and also with a game development company who put this all, our ideas of how we could make this into a so-called series game into this program. And I'm also shortly going to show you a video of one of the modules that we used to train to recognize faces. It's called Face Puzzle. It has different difficulty levels. And in the easiest variant, people are presented here with an actor that displays two different emotions. And the task of the participant here is to obviously puzzle the appropriate pieces together so that a coherent emotion emerges. As you see here, the little question marks, actually there's a big didactic platform in the background explaining semantic context of an emotion, explaining what happens in the body. And here, this is an explicit part where you have to actually label those emotions. This is the more simple tool, and we have other modules that are much more complex, where three or four actors even interact, and the people have to say what the people in the pictures are thinking and feeling. Now, we involved in that study almost 50 individuals with autism, with a high-functioning variant of autism similar to what Carl has that you saw in the video. And half of the group actually went through the training for 3 months, for 3 hours per week, training with this Scott here that you just saw. And half of the group actually trained with a similar online program that focused on visual attention and memory and some other fun games that had nothing to do with emotions. And so what we saw over the course of those 3 months, what happened is that this is a plot over time. So you see this is time point one and this is time point two after 3 months. You see in red here the Scott group that actually increases their capability of perceiving those emotions in faces, whereas the control group with autism that did the control training does not change their ability to recognize emotions. So that shows that on the behavioral level, the training did what it was supposed to do. We also used a film test that's much more complex where people had to see people interacting like in real life. And there we saw a similar pattern, that those people that trained with the Scott got better compared to the group that did not train recognizing emotions. At the same time, we did not only in that study look at behavior, but we also looked at the brain. We showed again in the MRI scanner, people, all study participants, here scenarios of people interacting, feeling different emotions, and we observed what their brains did when actually looking at those emotions. And what we found is that the Scott group, so that trained with that emotion training over the 3 months, compared to the control group, actually reduced their activity in some of the brain areas that are important for social cognition, for recognizing emotions. And interestingly, they actually reduced their activity. And that goes hand in hand with a lot of training studies that are out there also in different areas of training that show that once people get better, they get more efficient and they recruit less brain activity for that. Another evidence for actually that's what's happening shows you in this correlation where you see that those people that really reduce their activity most in those areas are the ones that benefited most from the training in terms of increase in emotion recognition. We also looked at the structure of the brain, which you can see here. So this is a 3D modeling of the surface of the brain, of the cortex. And you see that here, restricted to parts of the frontal cortex, we saw actually a thickening of the cortex. That's actually an area that's confluent with that area here. So which is nice because it shows that the brain activity as well as brain structure go hand in hand in basically showing, reflecting an increase in emotion recognition over time. So basically that study nicely showed that we can train empathy, that we can train emotion recognition in individuals with autism, that we also see it on a brain level. However, I've started that presentation with something very different, namely with kinesthetic empathy, with a very bodily-based empathy, and that's what I want to turn to now also. So we know now from research, actually part of the research that Sebastian has done, that imitation and synchronization, what happens to you when you saw this tightrope walker, is actually also related, seems to be related to some forms of empathy, such as emotion recognition, those cognitive forms of empathy. So those are actually some of the studies that Sebastian has mentioned also. We know that if people mimic facial expressions of others, they get also better at recognizing those emotions in others. And we have tried to use this, those findings and this rationale to, again, construct an intervention for people with autism that is very different from the one that I showed you now, because it actually focuses on the body. We have teamed up with a choreographer and a dance movement therapist and designed a 10-week intervention program that focuses on imitation and synchronization in people with autism. And I also brought you a little excerpt of that intervention, which is now manualized also. So you see here exercises in small groups, where always one is following, the others are leading. We always had 8 to 10 individuals with autism in one group and 2 instructors. Then circle dances. Thank you. always brings me in a happy mood to see this again. So this went on for 10 weeks, and you saw us different elements that focus on interpersonal synchronization and imitation. And again, similar to the study design that we had in that other study, we included again two groups of people with autism. 24 went through this synchronization and imitation intervention, and then 23 went through a circle training intervention that also lasted for 10 weeks, had a similar or comparable amount of physical activity involved, same room, same instructors, and also for 10 weeks in groups of 8 to 10 people. So what did we see over the course of this intervention? First, we looked at, did the intervention actually change imitation and synchronization? So what we really had first set out to do on a very close generalization level, as we call it. We used an automatic imitation task where we actually saw, I'm not going to go too much in detail here, but it basically shows how much somebody imitates without even wanting it. So you're supposed to do a task that's not even related to the hands that you see here, but what you can see in people is that they also move the hand depending on whether here different fingers are actually moved. And what you see is that in our group that did the synchronization and imitation dance, they actually increased their tendency to imitate others, even on an automatic level, after the 10 weeks, whereas the control group did not do so. Then we used a synchronization task. It's actually a tapping task, where a subject taps plays the bongos with virtual partners over the internet. And what we see here, here the dependent measures asynchrony, so you have to kind of turn it a little bit in your head. So what you see is that the synchronization and imitation group actually get lower in their asynchrony. In other words, they get more synchronous after the intervention, whereas the control group did not change those behaviors. So that means that on a very close generalization level, our intervention did what it was supposed to do. It increased synchronization and imitation. But that's actually not why we did it. We did it because we wanted to see, does this have an effect also on other aspects of empathy, namely on the understanding of others' emotions? And that's, we tested with this photo-based test here, where we showed people those pictures and then asked them what are the people feeling that you can see in the pictures. And what we saw here over time is that, again, the people that did the synchronization and imitation movement intervention actually increased their ability to recognize others' emotions, whereas the control group did not change their ability to do so. So in other words, we do see a transfer effect. We see that the one facet of empathy, kinesthetic empathy, can have an effect on cognitive empathy. And that already brings me to the end. This is my last summary slide. So I've shown you two different interventions, and the first one actually shows that training cognitive empathy alone also increases cognitive empathy, but then you can also make use of other facets of empathy, such as kinesthetic empathy here, to actually also target the same functions with this more basic underlying mechanism of bodily empathy. And with that, I want to thank you very much for your attention, and obviously also thank my collaborators and co-workers for this work. Thank you.
Wow, great. I'm saying wow because actually I'm feeling quite also emotional listening to your talk, because some of the first early research that I did was actually with music therapists working with children who had mild to severe learning difficulties, including parts of the autistic spectrum. And it totally reminds me of some of the findings that you had in terms of synchronization and holding eye contact and duration of kind of beats in a sense. And of course, music is one of those beautiful mediators in a sense that can kind of support a neutral space that allows people with such difficulties to kind of come in as verbal expression is so difficult for them. Some of the things that I just wanted to ask about was actually, so you talked about this 10-week period of each of the courses. Have you done any follow-ups on that, like we'd say a year after, or has there, or could you kind of like follow up on that in terms of your conversation about other research that is kind of looking at these lasting effects? And I'm interested also because that was some of the limitations of our earlier work at that time. And then the other was also follow up in relation to the school context or the family context, So they would, I'm talking about a UK context and a Scottish context where music therapy was generally delivered in very, in cases of schools that are quite highly socially deprived. It's not often delivered in the public service. So it's a very particular type of an intervention. And then it gets maybe one injection of a bit of money and then there's nothing thereafter. And therefore then the use, the usefulness of this kind of like disappears, even though the children were flourishing in that particular time. So it would be really good to hear a little bit more about that from the German context as well, and also in particular of your thoughts or the work in relation to the school and family follow-up.
Yeah, those are very good questions, and I mean, I know that you have worked in the field, so that that's really interesting to talk to you about. Maybe to your last question, I have to admit that I'm not so much into the clinical work and clinical service to have a good overview of what's actually paid for exactly in Germany and what's implemented within psychiatric wards. My limited experience that I had is that it always depends very much on the head of departments and how they would stand, you know, vis-a-vis those kind of interventions. One has to say, to defend them maybe a little bit, that there's very, very little work that actually shows the effectiveness of those kind of interventions in a more methodologically rigorous way. So there's a lot of so-called anecdotal evidence and yes, clinicians and using with children and adults with disabilities, you can see that it does work, but that's, you know, you still have to make the move to translate that into research that's actually, that shows that's rigorous enough to be able to show that there are effects, because I mean, after all, this is money that is paid for by everybody, by the society, and you know, I can kind of understand that one would put this more towards interventions that have maybe a little more ground. This is not to say that I don't think it works, and I think our dance study, that's why in part I'm kind of emotionally attached to that work, is that when we started with it, people were sometimes rolling their eyes saying, oh, this is almost esoteric, you know, when you deal with dancing and chanting a little bit together, people laugh at you also a little bit secretly, yeah, yeah, you know. Yeah, yeah. So to do this in a rigorous way, and we actually were able to publish this quite highly, this work, is something that I'm also proud of, and I think we need more of this kind of work than to then also eventually change reality in clinics more so. Yeah. And your first question, that was
the family and the school.
Yeah. So I have to say that in those kind of studies, mainly due to lack of money, we did not follow up those patients. But that's obviously a very important thing to do. And it's a very good question. And actually, that's something that we implement in our new studies now. We have a study going on with autistic children, for which we also designed a very similar intervention. A PhD student in my group, Simone Kirst, did a great job to develop a fantastic software. And we are running this study, and we have 3 months at least follow-up. And there it looks actually pretty promising, so the effects were stable over time. Because you're right, I mean, much can happen with those effects over time. Some just totally vanish, go off, but in some you have also planted a little seed, you know, that maybe even after the intervention you see very little, and then you're astonished to see a year later that that little was enough to actually, for the individual to be able to develop those skills to a higher degree.
And do you know of any research at the moment with families then after this? So you have the intervention perhaps, and then how that might trigger out to supporting the family to know how to
deal with,
do these little synchronization, bongo, you know, these little tasks in a way.
No, this is actually, with this we are not at the moment following up, but that would obviously be very important. But that's again this restriction of doing research sometimes in this ivory tower, not having the means and the time, the money to really take this then also into practice. That's really a pity. But in this children's study that I just mentioned, actually the parents are involved right away. They actually act as tutors. So they try to increase what we call generalization into everyday life. Okay. So the skills that people learn on the computers, obviously that's great, that's a good first step, but what we really want is to change people's social lives in reality. And so this is what we call generalization of skills into everyday life. And we use the parents as tutors as in this task, actually, so that they can always refer to situations in the kids' lives. So when did you encounter fear the last time? Or were you yesterday afraid? Or what about anger? When did you observe anger the last time in children? And when something happens in the kids' environment, the parents can right away refer actually to the software and to what the kid has learned. So with that, we hope really to strengthen this generalization.
Inspiring. Thank you.
Thank you.
Pablo, can we open it to the floor? Is there a possibility for that? Yeah? Have we... Yeah, we've got 15 minutes for...
Well, you all showed different facial expressions in a context of how will people react to these expressions. So my question is, in the people that you show there, did you actually tell them a joke so they will laugh? Did you show them a disgusting thing so they will react with real disgust? And my question is, because it's different when I say smile for the picture, when you are genuinely smiling of happiness. And I'm guessing the reaction of people when we see these real, genuine expressions to the fake ones that we can fake may be different, and then results may be different. I understand, like, for the autism analysis, the expression maybe have to be really, you know, really clear for them, but maybe in the other analysis, if there will be a difference when you express genuine emotions in your face.
Rather than showing some of this more exaggerated expressions that I showed in my videos, are you referring to the videos that I showed, or
Sebastian?
But you all show certain faces, and I think maybe the reaction is different when you see like a fake smile.
That's true. And actually, some people with autism commented on that, you know, obviously that it was very strong, the emotions that were shown. However, we have chosen this approach, and I think there is actually research on showing that it is a difference. And as Ursula Hess has pointed out, and you stated, Sebastian, that people react also in a weird way if something is exaggerated too much. However, if you want to teach somebody who has really a lack of an understanding of emotions, I think a certain kind of exaggeration is needed to also show what's happening in the face, to use the very often superior intellectual and systemizing capacities of people with autism to put their models, you know, on the faces. And I think, at least as a first step, it's helpful to have those stimuli.
Yeah, it is working. Okay. Yeah, so also I was trying to use videos which go from one full-blown expression to another. But the interesting part is actually that you get the sort of in-between stages because they morph from one to the other. And the focus of the participant is not so much on the full-blown emotion and more on sort of when does it change from one to the other. So that's also a way to get at sort of more ambiguous and maybe less, you know, like less full-blown emotions. But indeed, it would be very important, and some people are already doing this, to study reactions to expressions which are more common in everyday life because they're not so strong as we show them on the pictures.
You approached a very important topic that we also call often in psychology ecological validity. So we often see this, especially in social neuroscience, that people are in kind of an experimental quarantine, and we look at their social and emotional behavior, but they just sit like in a box when it comes worse, and we measure EEG so that all the frequencies are shut up and they are completely alone. And I think that's also where social neuroscience is heading now, that we really want to have real smiles and people really interacting. However, we sometimes have some methodological problems there, because as soon as we measure EMG or EEG, we have a poor signal-to-noise ratio, meaning that actually we can only see effects if we present many times a particular stimuli in order to get our statistics. So that's kind of the thin line between methodological control and real smiles and ecological validity that we, I guess we try to improve in the future.
I think we had a... And then... Yeah.
Hey, so my twin brother has Asperger's, and he's one of the smartest people I know, like, was playing Jimi Hendrix when he was, like, in third grade by ear, and I know, like, his whole life he's been always very opposed to any sort of therapy or, treatment. And I'm just curious what you think about teaching society as a whole more about being empathetic to these type of people rather than trying to normalize them or change them. I also have a friend who's highly autistic, and she's almost 19 now, and she has done therapy her whole life. Her parents have been very supportive, putting her in like the best schools, but she hasn't like changed at all. So I'm wondering like how we can educate people to be more empathetic to these people who lack empathy or social recognition.
Yeah, that's, I think, a very good point. And actually, fortunately, something that people are increasingly recognizing, certainly in science, I mean, society maybe not so much, but there has been some media coverage. And I think it's a very important point to not always think we have to kind of bend people with autism or with other disorders, disabilities, you know, however you might call it, to be better fitting into the society. So there's actually this whole movement that's called neurodiversity movement, that people with autism don't even see themselves as having a disorder or being sick, and they don't see the others of not having autism as the healthy ones, but they call them neurotypical. So we are maybe the typical brain, and there's other variants, you know, that are not necessarily sick, that are different. We are all individuals, and so I very much embrace this kind of movement, and I actually interact closely with autistic people. I actually found it already 10 years ago, a participatory research group. So there's about 30 people with autism and researchers from Humboldt University, from Freie University, that do research together as partners. Not we as a scientist think what's good for the autistic people, what should be researched, and always do biomedical research, because that doesn't help people with autism now. That doesn't get their strength out. That doesn't tell us how we can increase inclusion. And so in this group, actually, people with autism decide what we do research about. And most often, those are projects that really can contribute to better inclusion of people with autism. And I think that's a very, very important movement.
Thank you. Lady, and then the lady at the back.
Hello. Okay, I'm here. I do have a question. Did you ever have a problem with the children understanding why they should imitate? Like if they did not understand like action and consequences, did you ever have a problem with that?
Could you repeat the question, please?
Okay.
For whom is the question?
For the two last of you talking. Background is, I have a brother that has Angelman syndrome, so he has a little bit of hint of autism. And so he has a very hard time to learn because he can't imitate, because he doesn't understand why he should imitate, because he doesn't understand action and consequences. So I wonder if you had that problem with some of the people you've tried, like how to inspire to imitate is pretty much the question.
Yeah, good question. I mean, yeah, part of the reason for why we did this is actually, in fact, the observation in people with autism that there are difficulties in imitation. The interesting thing was that, and that's actually mainly due to Andrea Behrens, the dance movement therapist who was really, who created that that intervention. She did it in such a nice way that people really felt invited, people with autism, to participate in interaction, in movement interaction, rather than saying, oh, imitate that. I'm doing this, you do this too, right? This is probably not the right way of doing it, and I'm also opposing actually the typical ABA approach in autistic children, where you break down different behaviors in little parts and then you constantly reinforce them, and you treat children for 40 hours a week with this kind of intervention or therapy. So I think that's always, it's very much a question of how you approach and how you offer interventions. And actually the interesting thing is, very often you hear also in the media, people with autism are computer apt. They love computers. That's why we thought when we invented or when we came up with this computer intervention, people would love it with autism. However, we had about a 20% dropout. So every fifth person actually left the intervention in the midst of it because they didn't like it so much. In this dance intervention, where you would always think people with autism are often clumsy, they don't like interacting on a bodily level with others, we had one person withdrawing from the study, and that was because he moved into a different town. All the other people actually went and did this whole intervention, so they were highly motivated actually in engaging with others, synchronizing with others.
And I think that goes back very much to what you opened with in terms of the kinesthetic experience of empathy, because actually it's anxiousness that your brother is feeling. I mean, if I don't like to do something, I'm highly anxious, you know? I mean, if the reinforcement has always been negative feedback to me as well, I think the dance therapy and the music therapy is this non-verbal relaxing introduction, in a sense, which is engaging the other parts of the body, you know, rather than it being all in the head. I think it's sort of vital in a way, and I think everybody can associate it with that aspect. We had another question on the floor.
Based on your presentations, I realized that the research between empathy is very much, or the emphasis is very much on visual expressions. And I was thinking whether you know anything about empathy in blind people since birth. How is that different? How is the development of empathy maybe also different? And how, which may be other factors that contribute to that? Because especially in the first presentation, you were describing the recognition of emotions due through facial expressions and prosocial behavior. So I was wondering, are there also other ways that this would work, and whether there are any results or research or information about, for example, people that are being born blind, and how does this develop in these individuals?
Yeah, good question. Yeah. So again, I think an example how based the whole neuroscience is on the visual system, because it's quite easy to present visual stimuli, and we know a lot about the visual system. But there are also people looking at emotion processing, for example, in sounds and spoken words. And also there is now a lot of research starting regarding touch, and I think also the role of oxytocin in touch. So I think that might be more a little bit like a methods confound now that this seems so visual. I would not say that that vision is more important for empathy. I think all the senses play a role here, and especially if we talk about the embodied approaches, that was kind of an underlying topic of all the presentations, but we never really shouted out loud, by the idea that we always embody the other with us, that we constantly, I mean, yes, of course, in the mimicry presentation it was part, but mimicry is not restricted to the face, as we also gave the example. So I think all the senses are important for those processes, and I hope that future research will tackle that more. I'm not aware of studies in blind people regarding empathy. Do you know any? Or
There are studies actually in deaf people, in blind and deaf people, because that's even more interesting also if you think that people are shut out completely and they yet develop empathy more so over the touch sense, then there is definitely work on that, but I also cannot tell you exactly how it looks.
We had another question, I believe.
Sure.
This.
Thank you, I have the mic. Okay, I just wanted to ask a question and make a comment. The question would be, are there studies about people who are formally diagnosed with autism, especially as they grow up, as to whether they are more, less, or about the same in terms of what might be called sociopathic behaviors and drug taking. That's my question, whoever wants to field it. Comment would be, it's in the form of a question. If autism is to some degree defined as the inability to express empathy, how do we distinguish between Donald Trump and an autistic person?
Yeah.
Maybe I can start, and probably Isabel can say more about this. I think that often autism and psychopathy are seen as the two opposite ends of the spectrum. Because we have heard, for example, in Isabel's presentation that you have different types of empathy. One type of empathy I was focusing on is called more emotional empathy, and is more the sort of really sharing through imitation of the other person's emotions. And the other type, and that might actually be impaired in psychopathy. While the other type of empathy is more cognitive and involves understanding that other people have thoughts and feelings which differ from ours, and that they might not have our same point of view. That if you leave the room and I move this bottle away and you come back, I need to know that you are not aware that this bottle has gone. So that's the type of cognitive empathy. And so one theory says that autism has more problems with cognitive empathy. I don't know if I explained it well, but maybe Isabel can say more about this.
I would have said it the same way, and Donald Trump is probably more on the psychopath and sociopath way, whereas people with autism, actually when we show them the test that I showed you in the end, where we show people in situations where they suffer and so forth, and we ask them not only what is this person feeling, but we also ask them how much pity do you feel for that person? People with autism, you cannot distinguish between people with autism and people that don't have autism. However, sociopath and psychopath, actually, they say they don't care for the people in the picture, right? So that's exactly the difference that Sebastian has referred to. And your first question was, I mean, in our study, we excluded people that took drugs, so medication, that were on medication. That was one question, and the other one I don't really remember.
Join with the point about sociopathic behavior. Are autistic people, as they go through their careers, not in controlled settings or whatever, do they register relative to the general population the same in terms of sociopathic behaviors, which you might define as criminal behavior, drug taking, alcoholism, those sorts of things? Do they have the same sorts of profiles or not?
Now I understand. I know that people with autism have less, I mean, there's little studies on that going on. We know in general psychopathology, so comorbidity, how many people with autism have other diagnoses, including those of substance abuse, is generally high. More than half of the people with autism also have another diagnosis. However, drug use or even nicotine intake and other alcoholism is much less prevalent in people with autism than in people without autism. And sociopathic behavior is, I guess, from the studies that are out there, is pretty similar to this in the general population. There are always, obviously, and in the press we see those cases, oh, there's this offender or this person that goes amok, and he or she might have had autistic traits, you know, that's picked up readily by the media, but it doesn't represent actually the general numbers.
I think we're quite close to wrap-up time, and I do feel that this somehow could kind of go on for much longer, as I think that there's both, you know, an interest in the research, but also touches upon people's personal sort of circumstances as well, and that's also quite clear too. We didn't get around to maybe looking at how this research actually relates to the sentimental machine, and I think that that's also really, really interesting, and possibly even a resurgence in the interest of this type of work, which, as you mentioned, Isabella, was sometimes considered as the fringe, but now that we're going to be interacting more with, you know, AI and robotic forms, in a sense, I think that the application of this type of work is also kind of being brought much more into that, and I think that this is really interesting and will probably continue to filter down. But I think it's really nice to close with the statement that you responded to in relation to the question about learning how to basically live with each other in a more empathetic way, even if this is a very different creature that's in a human creature that's in front of you. I think that's at least a positive nod to the end of this, and something that we should maybe take away in terms of typical or atypical brains. And thank you again for your time and your energy and passion today. And thank you all for participating. Great.